Good morning, sir, and we are very happy to welcome you to our WASN team. We are highly privileged to have you here with us today. EduTalk series invites guest speakers like educationists, elite group leaders to share their experience and create awareness about different parenting and teaching do's and don'ts. They inspire teachers to keep raising the bar, become better professional, and it aims at guiding parents and teachers on how to develop 21st century skills. Today we have with us our guest speaker, Sir Tishok Bhish, and presently he is the principal of Delhi Public School, Ghaziabad, Vasundhara. He is passionate about education and he has a rich experience of 32 years as an educator. His area of specialization is economics and mathematics. During his long career, he had the privilege of working with several prestigious institutions. His earlier stint was of Jodhamal Public School, Jammu, where he had been a principal for 8 years. He is a proud recipient of National Teachers Award 2016 and 17. He is also a master trainer under the CBSC. He has been awarded the Fortune 50 Principal Leadership Award 2018 and 2019 for his outstanding work as an educationalist. He has also been awarded Outstanding Service to the Society Award by International Award Young People for his contribution in the field of education. We are highly obliged to be in your presence, sir. Thank you so much for joining with us today.
Thank you, Bhavya. Thank you so much for inviting me to your platform to speak out my mind. Thank you. Thank you for a wonderful introduction.
Thank you, sir. So, sir, before we begin the interview, I would just like to ask, like, what inspired you to become a principal, to have so many people or so many students under your guidance, and like, what makes you inspire them?
See, Bhavya, when I was a child, when I was in class 4th and 5th, I used to teach class 6 children in the 9th period after the school was over. And my teacher, Mrs. Chaya Sharma, my Sanskrit teacher, she inspired me to be a teacher. Then I had a music teacher, Mr. S.N. Patil Guruji. He inspired me to do something, you know, selflessly for the nation, because that a Guruji of ours, he used to teach all of us the Sangeet after school hours for 4-5 hours, free of cost. So that was an inspiration where I felt that I also need to become a teacher. Principal is a part of a teacher only, you know. A principal is first a teacher, then the principal. So yes, my aim was to become a teacher. And I wanted to be a teacher right from class 4th only. So you can think of it was a long cherished dream. And where I am today, it's all because of my passion. Yeah.
It was really great hearing, sir. So, sir, what according to you are the 21st century skills? Like in our day-to-day lives, what are those skills that actually we are learning, but we do not know that they are part of those skills?
See, in the 21st century, we need to have a lot of skills which are actually in the seep deep into our system. Actually, if you really talk about WhatsApp video calls, we're making video calls to our parents, our children, our friends, relatives, but we do not know it's working on the artificial intelligence. So AI has become a norm of the day. The children have to understand the artificial intelligence and machine learning, which is going to be the 21st century skills. And the most important skill in the 21st century is going to be the communication skill. If you can communicate what you want to say to the people, I think that is going to be the best skill altogether. So communication skill, your international mindedness, that is a global citizenry, then your being very confident, being very tech-savvy, highly tech-savvy, knowing about artificial intelligence, knowing about what is machine learning, what is robotics, all this is very, very important today, be it any subject.
Yes.
During this pandemic, you know, we all switched on to the virtual mode of teaching. This also happened, was possible only because of this artificial intelligence and the machine learning. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to have this interview online, what we are having right now.
Yes,
through the Zoom. So all this is very, very important. These are the most important 21st century skills. I remember 3 years back, when I was to be interviewed by one school in Bangalore, I said, I can't travel to Bangalore from Jammu, so you take a Skype interview. They were very apprehensive taking the Skype interview. And today it has become a norm of the day. People are preferring talking to the people on the online. Interviews are all online, you know.
Yes.
This is what is going to be the 21st century skill. The change. Accepting the change is also very, very important, because change is the only thing which is going to be more permanent. And I'm sure this change which has taken place in the last 1.5 years, I think we people have really improved our digital literacy from, almost by 10 times we have gone up. 10 years time we have already traveled in 1.5 years. So I think that is what is the most important skill for the 21st century, to be technically very sound and to be very passionate about what you're doing, have the communication skill, and of course the international mindedness, where the differences of demographic differences are no more a difference. Whether you're in Timbuktu or you are in India or you're in America, you can just talk through one Zoom call or one virtual call. Medium can be anyone, anything. Like, it can be Teams, it can be Google Meet, it can be Geo Meet, it can be Google Team, and the Zoom as we are talking. So I think this is very, very important now. These are some of the skills which have come to my mind.
Yes, sir. So like you talked about cooperation, and you talked about that interactive skill should be one of the most important part that we should learn. But nowadays, like, children are getting very laid back attitude. Like, they're sitting behind the laptops 24/7. There is no interaction. Usually we mute our mics and we attend classes and we are done for the day. So how do we inculcate these habits in our day-to-day life?
See, Bhavya, it depends from school to school, how the school is taking it forward. Like in my school, we have the interactive rooms also. Like, you know, what we are doing, we're not just teaching them. We are giving them some discussion topic and they go into the discussion rooms, the sub channels. They go in the group of five, where they are all friends. They can chat, talk, interpersonal skills can be developed. Then they prepare a pecha kucha presentation. After 20 minutes, they come back to the main channel and then they all present five minutes only. You know, in those 20 minutes when they were together, they were discussing, collaborating, collating, and cooperating, and then coming to a common consensus. I think that there we are able to create that interpersonal skills amongst the children, that interactive learning from each other was happening. So it depends on how the educators are taking it forward. Are they making it monotonous, one-way story altogether, that the teacher is speaking, children are with their video off, audio off, they're doing something else and they're least bothered about who the teacher is speaking. So we need to give them a little space. We need to give them the space even on the virtual mode. We cannot just flood with the knowledge at the same time. You know, we have to make them understand that this is the topic, and we must create an inquiry-based learning. Inquiry-based learning is when the student becomes he takes the charge of his own learning. The child must have a choice and must have a voice in his learning. And that can happen only when we have the discussion rooms created in the school, in the classroom, only in the channels. And then they meet each other, they talk to each other, they greet each other also. It's not that for 20 minutes they're all discussing about the topic which we have given to them. They may be talking, what are you doing? You know, whatever they're talking, you may be quietly visiting without disturbing and keep moving to different channels. So I think this is how we can create interactive learning even during the virtual classes.
Yes, sir. And sir, mostly people are facing issues like adapting to this new system of, you know, virtual world, and continuously we are on our laptops. So that adaptation skill is very important nowadays. So how do you think that teachers and parents can help children to develop those skills?
I think, Bhavya, it's too late a question now, because, you know, it was 1.5 years back we started. We got within 3 months, we could get the children acclimatized to the virtual classes. But there are schools where the things are still a problem, especially the government schools, where the children have no access to the internet. They don't have the access to the mobiles. Forget about the laptops and the tabs and all. So I think your question is relevant for those classes. But since I've been taking the workshop for government schools also, I've been telling them that virtual classes doesn't mean that, you know, even in the remotest of remote areas, mobile phones are there, but they may not have the smartphone. They might have the SMS facility. So we can just send them as a text on the SMS, tell them to work on it, find out something, research something, and then they can revert back to the teachers. So we can do that, but that stage is also gone now. It's been almost 1.5 years. I think even in the remotest of remote places where the school teachers have started making the walls as a classroom kind of a thing, you must have seen it's in the WhatsApps also. I think people have to look for case-to-case basis. Need-based, strategies have to be developed, you know, for us as a GOB, highly elite DPS schools and all. We have people coming out from very good families, so there's no issue of laptop, no issue of the iPads and all. So our children are using their iPads. So for them, it was very easy to acclimatize to it. And we are running full swing, completely everything is happening. But only thing which we have done in the DPSG society is, we have been giving, after every period, there's a 10 minutes break is given so that the screen time is reduced. It's not a continuous screen time for the children. And after every 3 periods, there's a half an hour break. So this way, we are running from 7:30 to 2:30 with the breaks and 10 minutes break after every period and half an hour's two breaks altogether. This way, the children also enjoy. They also wait for the teachers and friends to come online, because otherwise they were cut off from the world. So they really love meeting their friends, at least if not the teachers.
Yes, yeah. Sir. So nowadays there's another problem that we are facing, like children are on their laptops, they sit in their own four walls and they have, like, they don't have that interaction with their parents. So there has been a rift created between the parents and the children. So how do we, like, those decision-making skills of making decisions for the home and being a part and being involved in their home, there is a lack there. So how can parents bridge this gap between them and their children?
See, this depends a lot on the parents and also depends on the schools. If the schools are the parental sessions also. In the parental session, we talk to the parents how to connect with the child. Child is already in a cocoon kind of a thing. Within the four walls of the house, they're just, locked up over there.
Yes, sir.
So how do we bring them out? How do they can connect with the children? And they can find out the free time. When they have a free time, sit down, play with the children. They can have the indoor games played. They can play carom with the children. They can have antakshari with the children. They can do something, you know. And our DPS society has also, DPS Ghaziabad society also came up with a session in the morning. 7:30 to 8:30, we are having a sports session. And in the sports session, we have a yoga, we have exercises, warm-up exercises and all, in which we are inviting the parents to join their children. Not all, but 60%, 70% parents who are joining, they're really feeling it's so worthwhile. It's really good to be connected. That way, you know, they're doing with their children, they're connecting.
Yes.
They're talking while they're doing the exercises. They say, you're not doing it rightly. No, better you have to put your hand like this. So at least that interaction is happening. Whereas the children were getting cut off from their parents, I think through games, sports and interactions at home, the parents can take the onus. They can take the charge of connecting with the children.
Yes, sir.
In a way, children have a lot of, I won't say self-respect, they have a lot of ego these days. You know, children are very egoistic. They really, when we were kids, whatever our father or mother said, that used to become a word for us. You know, we used to take it as a word, final word in the family.
Yes.
But today's children, they know how to argue with the parents, how to get the things done the way they want. Then the parents have to come and consensus with them, become their friends, be like a friends with them, not exactly the friends, be like friends. There's a difference between like friends and being friends.
Yes.
When you become only friends, then they sit on your head and make you dance to their tunes. Being like friends means treating them nicely, but that streamlined distance between a parent and a child has to be maintained by the parents. That depends on the parents. If the parents break that line, then the children take the parents for the ride. So I think a lot of parental counseling is needed. Our parental sessions are very, very important, where the school's counselor can connect with the parent and the child together. there are certain ways, you know, there are so many ways to get the children back to the parents. You know, actually, they are getting disconnected with the family.
Yes.
And, this is what is happening.
So actually, we are so caught up in our work, on sitting on the laptops the entire day. Like, we have lost the touch of the physical world, basically. Those skills, interpersonal skills, they are just going back somewhere.
Very true, Bhavya, very true. That interpersonal skills have to be developed. And for that, parents need to have that, you know, once in a day, a father can come and say, hi, beta, give a hug to the child. You know, that physical and personal touch has to be brought. I think the parents also don't have the time right now. They're also working from home. They're also too stressed, because this work from home is much more tougher than the working from the offline mode.
Yes, sir.
In offline mode, you were 9 to 5, you were working. But now they're 24/7, they're working. So they don't know when the boss is going to make a call on the, you know, WhatsApp, this Teams call is coming up, or the Zoom call.
Yes, sir.
That there's a meeting of the staff at 9 at 9 p.m. You know, just an emergency call.
Yes,
so
sir.
Now,
yes.
The timings are not there. There's no restriction. So parents also feel difficult to get back to the children. So it's a both ways. Both are in a stress at the moment.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure that with a little counseling, with a little super positive aspect, if we, I give my students and parents, I just tell them, just fold your hands early in the morning and say 10 times or 11 times, yes, thank you, universe. Yes, thank you, universe. Just surrender to the universe. And then let the universe take care of you, take charge of you. And then start connecting with your children with a super positive mind, where your intent is going to be very good. It's the intent which makes different, not the content.
Yes.
So I think it's a universe which can, if we connect with the universe, then even if you're inside your room, you can feel the whole universe with you, right?
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. And so nowadays, like, we are just in our room, the class interaction is also lost somewhere. Like, we have lost how to work in a cooperative environment, how to develop those cooperative skills, a positive workspace environment. So how do you think that schools, teachers and parents can teach that skill to children? Like, sitting at home also, you should feel that you are a part of a classroom. You have that cooperation with your students, along your classmates. How can we bring that into our daily lives?
Bhavya, I've already talked about it, because in our school, we have the our discussion room channels separately, where we send them in the groups, and they, you know, they can connect with each other in the evenings also. When the teacher's not there, they can go to those Teams meeting. They can have it. It's not the teacher who's going to start the Teams meeting. If you have the access to the team, you can create your own team, and you can call your friends, discuss, collate, collaborate, debate, deliberate, and then finally come to a collaborative work which can be brought by the children. They can talk about their, they can plan their, they can have their birthday celebration virtually also. They can have, yes, so many things can be done, you know. If you,
yes,
have the intent, anything is possible.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, we have to think of how to convert this crisis into an opportunity. That is only that can only happen when we have a positive frame of mind.
Yes.
But the schools have to really bring that positivity in the children,
yes,
by counseling sessions, parental sessions, student session, career counseling sessions, behavioral counseling sessions.
Yes.
We are, in our school, we have a system of called peer educators group. I hope you have heard of peer educators group. It is a group where one counselor, two counselors of school cannot reach out to every child. So we have taken the 50 children who are trained as a peer educators. They travel to different channels, talk to the children, find out their problems, what are they facing. They try to give them some kind of a counseling. If they're able to do it, very good. If they're not able to do it, then those cases are reported to the counselor. So then the counselor, parent and child can sit together. But this peer educators program, which DPSG Vasundhara has kick-started in 2005, and now we are completing 15 years already done, and now we have traveled it far and wide. Now we have also shared it with this program with so many schools all over the country. We have almost 100 schools which have joined us for the peer educators program. We are connecting with Dr. Nagpal, who is a pioneer in the country when it comes to peer educators, or when it comes to Manodarpan, when it comes to, you know, psychological counseling. He is a big name. He's a mentor to our school, and now he's a mentor to all these 100 schools as well. And I think we're connecting to the children, making the children connect to the children. Because the children who are in a problem will not connect with the teachers. They don't confide in the teachers so easily.
Yes, sir.
But to their seniors, children to children, the confidence is born.
Yes,
they can speak. They can speak out their mind. And I think this kind of a peer counselors program or the peer educators program, whom I call as a mini counselors, can be kick-started in every school. I think children will be able to open up to them better. And then these children, since they will be trained properly how to take care of everyone and how to take care of the confidence of the child also. If the child doesn't want it to be shared with the teachers, let the peer educators not share with us, but settle it at their own level.
Yes.
And, I think this is how we can take care of the children's mental health also.
Yes,
emotional health also.
So because nowadays there is so much like bad energy and we are becoming so pessimist regarding our day-to-day activities, that optimism, that practicality towards life is somewhere like it's lost. So we are basically facing those mental traumas, mental illness, children are going into depression, like the entire day they sit alone in the dark. So these problems are coming up nowadays at a very higher pace.
Yeah, and that is very true, but it's all happening. But then the solution also lies with us only. We can't
wait for
help. You know, charity begins at home.
Yes.
So if children have a problem, they should look for a solution for it. You can see behind me, there's something is written there. Can you see
that? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It says, are you here with a problem or are you here with a solution?
Solution.
So children have to think of solutions. I'm talking about 21st century education is all about student-led, inquiry-based education. Student-led, the student has to lead the education. He has to take the, he has to become the agency of change. And the child can start thinking on these lines. If the schools can provocate the children to ask more questions, to think about logical thinking, problem solving. If we are able to create all those into the children, if we can steer the children to start getting, looking for a solution at their level, then I think the problems will not be there. Because the time is, you know, as we are approaching 21st century is passing by, the more and more challenges will be faced by the children. If we do not prepare them to future ready children, they will not be able to do it. They'll succumb to all those challenges which are coming in front of them. So I think we need to prepare. The educationists have a big role to play.
Yes.
And a role to play, not to spoon feed the children, just to develop the skills and the competencies in the children.
Yes.
Do that spoon feeding. Earlier, you know, the children were mugging up the things, vomiting in the exam, getting good marks and forgetting everything what they've studied last year. Simply saying, Tera tujhko arpan, kya lage mera? You know, that kind of a thing was there.
Yes, sir.
Now the 21st century skills are when the children are learning the skills for the application-based skills. They can apply in the day-to-day life, right? So I think this depends on the education which the children are getting in a particular school. Every school has to take the onus and the responsibility of preparing these children as the 21st century children.
Right? Yes. And so nowadays, studies are becoming more research-based. Like earlier, we used to have a single book. We used to just copy down the answers, get good marks, and we were done. Our notebook was prepared. But nowadays, we are learning how to research also, visiting various sites, learning about different stuff. And through this, we also get to know like general knowledge. Like nowadays, so many things are happening in our country. And still, there are many children who are not even interested in knowing the general knowledge that is happening. So as a citizen also, they get to a level where they know and get to know about the country.
See, Bhavya, you've raised a very good point where we talk about the learning. Learning has to be research-based, it has to be innovative learning, it has to be skill-based, it has to be competency-based, it has to be inquiry-based. If it is not, then we are still living in the 20th century or the 19th century where we're just mugging up, vomiting out and getting marks, and that was end of it.
Yes.
Now the time has come when we have to learn application-based studies. Whatever we are studying, are we able to apply? And are we able to research out what we are studying? Can we do a little research to know a little more about it? So research has become a very good parameter for studying, and for that you must have seen we are coming up for the class 9 to 12. We have an internship also for the children. They do the internship with different companies. When you're going, suppose you're an economics student and you're doing, you're just mugging up and passing, you will not know how to apply it in the day-to-day life.
Yes, sir.
If you're going for the internship along with your studies, you correlate the two things. If you can correlate and you can research, you can do a little inquiry-based studies, you can have a little questions coming to your mind. Why, when the price is going down, we are demanding more? Why we are not demanding more when the price is more?
Yes, so
all these questions should come to my mind. If a child is asking me, if I ask a child, suppose the tomato is for 50 rupees per kg and another seller is selling for 30 rupees per kg, which one will you purchase? 90% children say, I'll go for 30%. One or two children will go for 50 rupees wala. But then you have to ask, what is the logic?
Yes, sir.
Sir, because you know, we find that 50 rupees cages of better quality, fresher, is organic. You know, if they have the reason, then it's okay. But if they're just saying that 30 rupees wala bechta and they're asking, bhaiya isi ko 50 rupees laga do, that is irrational behavior.
Yes.
So we have to make the children understand whatever the choices they're making, do they have the reason behind it? Do they have the logic behind it? If they have the logic, everybody is right. Nowadays, in the 21st century, whatever we are discussing, everybody can have different prospects for that.
Yes.
And everybody has a different opinion. And everybody's opinion can be right. Nobody can be right. Nobody can be wrong. Only thing is, what kind of a logic, what kind of a reasoning you're giving towards your answer, that makes a difference whether you're right or you're wrong. So yes. I think the research is a very good parameter for the 21st century skills. We talk about inquiry, we talk about research, we talk about skill, we talk about competencies. All these are very, very important. And finally, we talk about students' profile. How do we create the students' profile? What kind of community service the child is doing? In our school, if you talk about the DPS, Ghaziabad Society Schools, we have a citizenship as a subject. Citizenship is compulsory from 3rd to 12th, so that we tell the children who they are.
Yes, sir.
Who we are, what are our values, what we are going to live up in the future. Then the second thing, which is also a once in a week, one period is there, is for C-learning. C-learning is S-E-E learning. C-learning is social, emotional and ethical learning, which is an integral part of our education system in the DPSG society, because this comes from the head of our society. The chairman is Mr. Om Patak. These are all his brainchild, and which has been disseminated to all the 12 schools of DPSG society. And C-learning is really making a big difference. This is really telling the children to be emotionally stable, but at the same time, ethically also very stable. You know, ethics are very, very important in life. And then you know, the children feel like, you know, something is benefiting him or her. They just fall prey to it.
Yes.
Without looking at the ethics to it.
Definitely.
You see, your behavior has to be ethical, and you are going to be socially, emotionally very strong and stable. And we talk about all the four quotients, not only the intelligent quotient. We also talk about emotional quotient, spiritual quotient. As I told you, yes, thank you, universe is a part of our super positivity club, which is running in our school.
Yes,
and
sir.
The super positivity club talks about the mantra. This is the chant which we do. Yes, thank you, universe. Everybody speaks. Our greetings are also at times a connotation to exchange. Our greetings is also, yes, thank you, universe. How are you? What are you doing? So I think, yeah, yes, thank you, universe. And the super positive club is making a big difference. That is a spiritual quotient. And off late, the final and the most important, after the Sushant Singh Rajput's death, we have started talking about adversity quotient. How to manage the adversity. You know,
yes.
It's a big problem with the children, even whether it is a success or failure. Both ways we find that it's very difficult to handle. At times the success gets into your head, then you don't know how to behave.
Sir, both the situations are equally overwhelming if we see it from a perspective.
We have to make our children understand how to handle the adversity. Adversity, if there's a one stroke of failure, if you're gone, if you give up, then, you know, that is also to be taught to the children.
Yes.
We always talk about you have to get 100%, you get this, you have to do that. But we never say, but if you're not able to achieve your target, what to do? How to handle it? If you aim for IIT, if you're not able to crack IIT, what do you do? Some children, they succumb to it and they commit suicide or they do something which is unwanted. But that did we as parents or did we as teachers, did we as educators, did ever teach our children how to handle the failure? So I think that is also very, very important. This is going to be the 21st century skill, how to handle the adversity. So adversity quotient is going to be a very important quotient, which has to be developed by all schools through their indirect teachings, right?
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. And so nowadays, like you mentioned a very good point that ethics plays a very important part because children are losing that wisdom. They are losing that empathy towards situation. So how can you suggest like one advice or your little words to how to intertwine ethics into 21st century skills?
See, when we talk about the ethics for that, you know, I'll tell you one thing. This has to be led by example. I am as a father telling my son that you have to have the academic honesty. You should be truthful. You should do this. You should do that. You should do that. And suddenly a call comes from my boss. And I tell my son, just pick up the phone and say, Papa is in the washroom. So what did I teach him? All the values which I told him, that all goes down the drain. Because I'm sitting there, I'm telling him to tell a lie. So I think we have to lead by example. If the teachers, parents are going to live up the ethics, that will automatically seep into the children, you know. We talk about the academic honesty. Academic honesty, when we are taking a test, everybody wants the child to, you know, score better. So even if the children are using unfair means, parents are not stopping them. They're not insisting on not to do that. Say, but even if you get less marks, doesn't matter.
Yes, so sir.
These have to come through the example. One has to live these values. If I live these values, if I live by example, I think there's no reason for the children not to, you know, ape and copy and follow it.
Yes.
These values can be imbibed and infused only through the example.
Yes.
This is what I have to say.
Definitely, sir. And sir, like nowadays that people are in their own space, but still they do not question themselves. So how can you suggest children, teachers and parents should have those introspection skills? Like to understand what they are doing, how they are wrong, and what path they are going on, those introspective skills.
I think for introspective skills have to be developed, but before we develop this, we have to give them some kind of practices, you know. Like at home, the parents can sit and say, well, let's sit and what have we done this month? How the expenditures has gone 5,000 extra this month?
Yes, sir.
So let's sit and talk about it. So I think then the children become a part to this introspection. Slowly and gradually they can come. So suddenly if you want to put the introspection in their mind, they will not bother about it.
Yes,
so you have to involve them into the decision making at the home.
Yes.
If you are getting something, suppose you want the fruits or something, you can say, Peter, can you offer, just order online this things. Let the child find out. Let the child do the comparison between different online shops. Where you can get the things better quality, whether it's Amazon or somewhere else. So
yes,
the child has to understand. So introspection can only come when we give the child decision-making part. If you're not giving him any decision-making, you're just spoon-feeding him for everything, then where will this introspection will come into the child's mind? So I think for that, we need to change our methodologies. We need to change our relations with our children.
Yes.
Whether as a parent or as a teacher, we need to connect with them.
Yes.
And if we connect, then only we can create introspective skills in the children, right?
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. So because the generation is going at a very faster pace than your generation, every day something new is coming up. We are interacting that this is on social media and let's try this something. Let's go into graphic designing, like just for an example. So the generation is going at a very fast pace. So developing these 21st century skills is equally important in children also, just to keep pace with it.
Of course, the children are much smarter actually. If you really look at it, 1 year child I was seeing the other day, he knows how to open the video and see that twinkle, twinkle, little star. I have a caretaker in my house in Dehradun. We were there in the month of June for 3 days. The little child is 1.5 year old. Then he comes to our house. He takes my phone and quickly goes to YouTube and takes out. He says in his own language. He knows how to find it out. Voice search. Search. What was that? Santa Claus is coming around, riding on the wave. You know, he was doing that, and he could find and he could show me that Santa Claus coming with. And the child is very, very smart. Child is the father of the man. This is a very good old adage, you know. I think children are very smart. We are the ones who need to learn from them, actually.
Yes, sir.
So I think they are the digital natives. We are, I think you people are of the same category. You people are coming in the same level. But we as principals and teachers, we're very old, and we have to adapt to your ways and means. We cannot force our ways and means on you. I think this children are very smart. They are, most of them have those 21st century skills already, but they're all under the cover. We as educators have to just remove the cover and tell them you're capable of all this. You know everything. Everything is there in them. Only thing is that they need to have a little insight that I know this all.
Yes, sir. So that perspective is important, like show them the right way of using those skills. So, sir, since we are talking about the 21st century skills, so what do you think would be the future of education when we go further? Like, it is a very high speed life. So what would be the future of education currently?
Education is going to be a hybrid now. It will be a blended learning forever to now. It is not going to go. This virtual will not go off. It can be online teaching as well as offline teaching. It will be more of a hybrid teaching if somebody is not well. This pandemic has come with a lot of benefits also, because earlier when the child was having fever or something, he was absent, he was missing on his studies for 3 days, 4 days, 5 days.
Yes,
now
sir.
The child can keep a laptop in front of him and can see in the hybrid mode what is happening in the class. Hybrid mode is when the class, half the children are in the class and those who are missing, they can go to the class and see that. I think the hybrid education, hybrid mode is going to be the future of the education. It will be very, very highly beneficial, which will save the time of the children going to the coaching centers in the evening also and coming back, wasting their time, coming and going and roaming around here and there. I think this is going to benefit those who are actually serious with their studies, and the hybrid mode is the future of education, according to me. We can call it a blended learning, which is going to be a future of learning. And this is not going to go. This virtual mode will not go off. It will add on spice to our education system.
Yes, sir.
Like, you know, there are some weak students are there.
Yes,
sir. We call on Saturdays for the recreational classes, or we call them the, you know, we call them the love for teaching classes. You give some positive name and you call the children, but they all know they have been called and they feel very distressed. They have been called separately on Saturdays because they're the weak students. So now this hybrid mode will definitely help us. We don't have to waste their time coming from home on Saturdays, rather than on weekdays, in the evening or whenever the child has a problem. Teacher and the child can come on the teams, sit down half an hour, 40 minutes, clear the doubt of the child, so the child is ready to accept the things in the next day. Otherwise, that doubt keeps accumulating and the child is able to understand in the whole week and has to wait till Saturday, and then his doubt also keeps accumulating.
Yes.
So I think this can be a benefit which can be taken by the schools. In our school, we call them the PLP classes. So if we get the PLP, PLCs and all that, can really help us all. Right?
Yes, sir. And sir, before ending the interview, what would be your advice to parents and teachers, like to have that interaction between themselves, that they know and they are completely aware of their child, that where their child stand and what is he currently doing? Like, people have lost that touch also. Like, earlier we used to have PTMs and PTAs and we knew that what our child is doing, what is he up to. But nowadays that is also being lost. And certainly that privacy element is lost. So how can we keep up to that?
Bhavya, I would like to just give an advice to all the school owners and the principals, teachers. Please do have the online PTMs also, and do create a kind of a synergy between student, teacher and parents, because I call it a holy trinity of a school.
Yes.
In our school, what we are doing is every month we call it a reflective session.
Yes,
reflection,
sir.
Not the PTM, we are calling it the parental reflection, student reflection, and teacher reflection.
Yes.
During the month, what the teacher has taught, the teacher has to do the reflection. There's a reflection sheet the teacher fills up. Then the students are given the reflection sheets. They fill up their reflection. Then we call the parents. And how do we call the parents? This is very important. You know, you can't call them in the physical mode.
Yes.
On Saturdays is a non-instructional day for us. Only teachers have to come to the school. Children have only 5 days a week. So on Saturdays, what do we do? On that Saturday, the class teacher fixes 15 minutes for each child.
Yes.
Suppose
sir.
8 to 8:15, I'm meeting Bhavya and her parents, right? So yes. The privacy is also taken care of. And we can talk across what the child has done. Child is also there, parents is also there, teachers also there. We can discuss, we can reflect upon what went right, what went wrong, what improvement can be done, how can we improvise our transactions, how can we improvise the child's attention span, how can we improvise a little parental involvement into it. So I think then after 8:30 to 8:45, second parent, 8:45 to 9, like 15 minutes slot given to each parent.
Yes, sir.
Rather than calling them to the school, I found it was even better. It was much more fruitful than the physical parent-teacher meeting, because the physical one, all parents were coming, they were waiting behind each other.
Yes.
They were not confiding in other parents. They didn't want to say anything about the child if he's doing, even if he's doing wrong at home, they were not sharing with the parent, the teachers. But now the teacher and parent both feel more comfortable because they are in the absolute privacy.
Yes.
Talking, and they open up. If the child is not listening to the parents, they say he doesn't listen to me at all. They come up with all the problems they are facing. So reflective sessions are very, very important. Instead of calling it a parent-teacher meeting, if we call it parent-teacher-student reflection session,
yes,
and 15 minutes each child can get, I think that will definitely help our children to grow up, know their problems, and the teachers will also understand from the children where the child is not understanding. So if the teacher has to improvise the methodology of transaction, has to change her method of teaching, I think this reflection will definitely help all three of us, and all of us will be in the win-win situation altogether.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. Thank you for that piece of advice, sir. And thank you so much for sharing your own valuable time and giving us such good things and inspiring things that we can get into daily lives and teaching us things that are very important for the parents and teachers and even children to become a part of the 21st century community. Thank you so much, sir, for being a part of today's interview.
Thank you.